Hello and welcome, or welcome back to my channel. My name is David Novak. I have just recently embarked upon this book, The Silk Roads by Peter Frankopan. And sad to say, despite the enthusiasm with which I embarked, I have become somewhat disenchanted or disheartened by the book. I'm only 66 pages in, and this is not an area of specialty of mine, so anything that I say must be taken with a grain of salt. That said, I went into this year finishing up Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, and then sometime after that, I read Stephen Runciman's three-volume History of the Crusades. I think I did a video where I talked about what contemporary historians think about Stephen Runciman, and I went and looked back. I don't know if I mentioned Frankopan in that video or not. I will try to link it, but I went back to that original source to see what Frankopan had to say about Runciman, and turns out he credited Runciman with his whole career path, his whole career choice. He is a Byzantine scholar, and it was the reading of Runciman that made him move in that direction. Sad to say, however, Frankopan is no Runciman, and I'm inclined to, while I recognize the value of contemporary scholarship, I'm inclined to favor things that are older and even somewhat outdated if they are well written. And with this one, I find so much to the writing that really rubs me the wrong way. In fact, I've taken to only just starting on page 57, I've taken to grabbing a pencil and underlining the things that bug me. Pardon me, I'm not sure where I was at. I've only started marking it up as of page 57, but there were other quibbles I had even before that. The first chapter really could have used a map. There is none. There's all kinds of place names, and I don't, excuse me, know that a good atlas exists for this period, and trying to look up everything on the tablet or the phone is just not really useful. So there's that quibble. The other quibble was there is no bibliography. A book of this sort really needs to have one. There are endnotes, copious endnotes, but to cobble together a bibliography from those would be sort of difficult, I think. So those are qualms. And then the use of the material, he's already given me reason to become skeptical. So for example, in one part, even before page 57, he mentioned that something was in a source. We know from some source that blah, blah, blah. And I did check the footnote, and he wasn't concealing anything. The source was Sima Qian, the Chinese historian. I have a little book of his here. This is just a minor excerpt. The whole work itself is copious, and I have that somewhere but have not read. But the point being that a historian of that stature, you don't just relegate something like that to a footnote. You actually put that in the body of the text, generally speaking. So, for example, you know, if you were going to say, oh, as was mentioned in an old Greek poem, The Wine Dark Sea. Well, you wouldn't do that either. In that sort of case, you would mention that it was from Homer, that sort of thing. So it's just a quibble, and he didn't do anything deceptive or really outwardly boundary crossing by doing that, but it just sort of irked me. Let me get into the actual text. So, starting with page 57. As religions came into contact with each other, they inevitably borrowed from each other. Although it is difficult to trace this accurately, it is striking that the halo became a common visual symbol across Hindu, Buddhist, Zoroastrian, and Christian art. Dot, dot, dot. There's a red flag in that sentence from my long familiarity with the writing of M.I. Finley, and that is the phrase, although it is difficult to trace this accurately. As I say, I'm not an expert in this subject, but my guess is that what that means is it's impossible to trace this. And he's just kind of fudging to say it's difficult to trace this to make it seem like he has more knowledge than he has. And there's a lot of that sort of thing that happens in this book. Later on in that page, he writes, the center of the world had always been noisy, a place where faiths, ideas, and religions borrowed from one another. Just that phrase, the center of the world, is really kind of confusing. Now, I should say there are interesting ideas. I mean, that whole, it is striking that the halo became a common visual symbol across those various religions. That's an interesting thought, and it's useful to know and to think about. And the book is loaded with information. It's just a matter of teasing it out and then trusting him. And I'm not sure that I'm up for the task of teasing it out. The other thing that struck me right off is that it says it's a new history of the world. And on the back, it says, Frankopan realigns our understanding of the world, pointing us eastward. And I believe he is trying to do that. But that said, the opening is 100% conventional. He begins basically with Alexander, and he leads you to believe an interesting idea, but probably not true, and probably not really his intended implication, but he leads you to believe that Alexander established the Silk Roads. As I say, I'm simplifying a bit. It's a very interesting idea. Even if false, it gives you something to bounce off of. So I like that. But basically, he starts with Alexander, and then he moves into Rome. So it becomes, again, sort of a fairly conventional Western-centric viewpoint on things. And maybe it's inescapable because of his own Western origins. But regardless, it's not what I felt that I was coming into this for. Page 58. I'll read a little. These violent reactions were an attempt to counter the steady gains that were being made at Judaism's expense. It was important, therefore, that there were also locations where Judaism itself made progress. Okay, it was important. Important to who? Was it important to Judaism? You can't really say that. Was it important to certain prominent Jewish rabbis? He is not clear. And so because of that, you can't really rely on the sentence. Another thing that I had noticed previously in the book, which I did not note down, but I'll read you another sentence, which is, and I could be wrong on this also. In the kingdom of Himyar, in the southwestern corner of the Arabian Peninsula, in what is now Saudi Arabia and Yemen, Jewish communities became increasingly prominent as recent discoveries of synagogues such as the 4th century structure at Cana shows. So to simplify the grammar there, as recent discoveries shows. That's a common mistake we make all the time in speech and even in writing. And in Shakespeare's day, it was common to write that way. But in our day, you have to have subject and verb agreement a little better than that. So it would not be recent discoveries shows. It would be recent discovery shows or recent discoveries show. As I say, he makes that error. And in common speech, we would say something. We would say the pack of dogs attack the bunny. Strictly speaking, it should be the pack of dogs attacks the bunny. But we let that kind of thing go in speech all the time. In poetry, you have more leeway. As I say, Shakespeare does it. So, but it's not the first time in the book that that has cropped up. So it irritates me. Okay, later on that page, he says, hundreds of Christians were detained and executed. On one occasion, 200 who had taken sanctuary inside a church were simply burnt alive. Why simply? When 200 people are burnt alive, it sounds like it's anything but simply. So why simply? 200 people were simply burnt alive. It just does not compute. Okay, what have we here? Page 60. Oh, there's a page without something. Oh, it's just he brings up relics. Let me see. The sacred relics venerated by the local population, .. These included one of Buddha's teeth, as well as the basin he used for washing and a brush he used for sweeping, made of the kasha plant, but decorated with fine jewels. He dots the narrative with all these sort of not really necessary details, but just in my mind, I contrasted that to Runciman's narrative in the beginning of the book on the First Crusade, where he talks about the whole rise of the collection of relics, and it's very clear and very interesting. I would have hoped he would have done something like that across the board for West and East. He does not. This is like the first introduction of relics, and he doesn't make any sense of it. So, going on, cave temples had become a well-established way of evoking and enforcing a spiritual message, lying along trade routes and eliding the idea of sanctuary and the divine on the one hand, with commerce and travel on the other. So, cave temples had become, why not simply cave temples became, and then the whole eliding the idea of sanctuary and the divine with commerce and travel. Did it have to be phrased that way? It seems like it's making a complexity out of something that doesn't have to be so complex. And he does that frequently as well. So for example, it's a common human habit also. Frequently, instead of using the word road, he will use the word artery. So actually, by his writing style, this should be titled The Silk Arteries. And you can replace an old word with a new word that is more up to date, more current, more in vogue, and yet not improve on the thinking behind the word at all, or even update the thinking. Granted, the metaphor of an artery is very useful to the whole idea, but he falls back on that word all the time. The silk arteries, as I say. And this really annoyed me. So I'll read a little bit. This had an obvious parallel with Bamiyan in modern Afghanistan. Lying at the crossroads of routes linking India to the south, Bactria to the north, and Persia to the west, Bamiyan contained a complex of 751 caves supplemented by immense figures of the Buddha. Two statues, one to the height of 180 feet and another slightly older, approximately two-thirds of the size, stood carved into vast niches in the rocks for nearly 1,500 years until they were blown up and destroyed by the Taliban in 2001 in an act of Philistinism and cultural savagery that stands comparison with the destruction of religious artifacts in Britain and Northern Europe during the Reformation. Now, nobody was more outraged at the blowing up of those statues than me. My whole book, Against Holy War, opens with that scenario. However, an act of Philistinism and cultural savagery that stands in comparison, that has no place in a history book. Okay, page 61. Around the middle of the 7th century, the future seemed easy to read. To who? Christianity was on the march across Asia. You just don't need that. Why not just say, around the middle of the 7th century, Christianity was on the march across Asia? The future seemed easy to read is superfluous. I don't even think you can state that. At best, you could say the future seemed easy to read to a bishop writing in such and such a place. That's the best you can do. Otherwise, to say the future seemed easy to read in the middle of the 7th century is nonsense. Oh, and he's talking about Christianity for several paragraphs, and then he throws this. The most competitive and successful of the religions competing, the most competitive and successful, however, turned out to be a religion born in the little town of Bethlehem. Now, we know that according to the Christian story, Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem. But was the Christian religion born in Bethlehem? I don't know. I don't know the case. I doubt that it was. So that's erroneous. Given the progress that had been made over the centuries that followed the crucifixion of Jesus at the hands of Pontius Pilate, it should have been only a matter of time before the tentacles of Christianity reached the Pacific. I mean, what, you know, tentacles of Christianity, I mean, no. And then I don't know what the paragraph is that's after that. I found this just to be hokey. Actually, the last paragraph of chapter 3 and then the first paragraph of chapter 4 are somewhat problematic. I'll read you those. And yet, at the moment of the triumph of Christianity, chance intervened. A platform had been laid for a spiritual conquest that would not just connect towns and regions, but span continents. At that moment, however, a debilitating war broke out, which undermined the existing powers and opened up opportunities to new entrants. It was like unleashing the internet in late antiquity. Suddenly, a new raft of ideas, theories, and trends threatened to undermine the existing order and to take advantage of the networks that had been established over centuries. The name of the new cosmology did not reflect how revolutionary it was. Closely related to the words for safety and peace, Islam gave little sense of how the world was about to change. Revolution had arrived. This sounds like it's written for a television show, honestly. Gibbon, even given the scant amount, the relatively scant amount of information that he had, handles the rise of Islam so much better than that. I'll go into the next. I wrote hokey by that. The beginning to chapter 4. The rise of Islam took place in a world that had seen 100 years of turmoil, dissent, and catastrophe. In 541, a century before the Prophet Muhammad began to receive a series of divine revelations, it was news of a different threat that spread panic through the Mediterranean. It moved like lightning, so fast that by the time panic set in, it was already too late. No one was spared. The scale of death was barely imaginable. According to one contemporary who lost most of his family, one city on the Egyptian border was wiped out. 7 men and 1 10-year-old boy were all who remained of a once bustling population. The doors of houses hung open with no one to guard the gold, silver, and precious objects inside. Cities bore the brunt of the savage attacks, with 10,000 people being killed each day in Constantinople at one point in the mid-540s. It was not just the Roman Empire that suffered. Before long, cities in the east were being ravaged too, as disaster spread along the communication and trade networks, devastating cities in Persian, Mesopotamia, and eventually reaching China. Bubonic plague brought catastrophe, despair, and death. So that's an awfully long paragraph to introduce the bubonic plague, which then he completely drops after that. If he had begun with the bubonic plague appears, the whole paragraph would have had to have been cut down by 3/4, and it would have been a lot more clear. So that was annoying, but, and also in that little excerpt that I read, you can see that his starting focus remains, in his case, I would say Byzantium or Constantinople. I'm hoping he moves more, but we'll see. More to the east. So page 63. Stagnation took hold and the public mood toward Justinian soured. That just seems so contemporary a way of saying something, and you want to know the basis. I think he gets his information from Procopius, whom I have not read. He would do better to be a little bit more clear. Then I got tired of marking, so I went over a few pages without making any things. And then the last one that annoyed me was on page 67, which is where I'm at. Things only got worse in Constantinople. The unpopular and hubristic Phocas was murdered. His naked and dismembered remains paraded through the city's streets. I'll show you that, and you can see how I've marked it up. Phocas, P-H-O-K-A-S. I'm trying to do this in the mirror, you know. Phocas, right there. I don't know who the heck Phocas is. I guess you have to rely on the internet, but so, why call him the unpopular and hubristic Phocas, or P-H-O-K-A-S, as if everybody knows who you're talking about? We don't. There's been no previous introduction to this character. And then saying that he's hubristic without telling us any iota of information. Obviously, the information is there, and he's concealing it from the reader deliberately. So it's this kind of thing that I find super annoying. I'm sure there's a wealth of information in here, and at least for the time being, I'm going to try to keep reading, but I'm disenchanted, to say the least. And, you know, I've come to realize that this idea of a new history of the world is a popular marketing tool. And maybe he felt he had to make his manuscript conform to that marketing idea. Last year I read The Dawn of Everything by Graeber and Wenslow, and it was a horrible book, but it at least had the virtue of some original ideas. It was an absolute mess. I'm hoping that something can come out of this. As I say, it's an area where I have almost no background beyond Gibbon at this point. I mean, the more you read this, the more you marvel at what Gibbon accomplished. I am inclined to think that I might have been better to read something specifically focused upon the Persians or the Sassanid Empire or the Mongols, that sort of thing. I know he's going to be getting to some of that. At any rate, it's good to touch upon all this information. As yet, it is not going to be a DNF for me. As I try to become a better reader, I understand that one of the aspects to that, which I did not expect embarking on this project, is to be able to read things that you don't like very much, and to be able to get information and get use out of things that are poorly written and so forth. I understand that any historian like a Moses Finley read all of the literature, the copious amounts of literature, and was able to pull out the little bits of information that he needed, even though enmeshed within a bad presentation. Now, I am not a historian, and I don't have a driving interest like that. I'm just trying to figure out a little bit better the state of the world and how we got to be where we are. So I don't have quite the motivation to force myself through something that I'm not enjoying. But I'm going to stick with Mr. Frankopan, even though he is no Runciman. Thank you very much for stopping by my channel.